Hi viewers, in today's video we are going to continue with the gestational diabetes mellitus. Okay, so in the previous video we have discussed about the risk factors, classifications, the screening procedure and the effects of diabetes on pregnancy and the effect of pregnancy on diabetes. So now let us discuss the management part. Okay, so management part is a little vast topic, so we are dealing that topic separately. So when we come to the management of gestational diabetes, so as I always say, management always is divided into three areas of antenatal management, intranatal management and the postnatal management. So when we come to the antenatal management, so before we start with pregnancy, we are supposed to give prenatal counseling. So for whom this prenatal counseling is to be given? Okay, so already we have discussed the risk factors. Okay, so those mothers who are having risk of gestational diabetes, they have to be given prenatal counseling. So what we do in that counseling? Okay, so you have to give a clear idea about the gestational diabetes to the mother. You have to tell what happens when there is gestational diabetes for the mother, for the child, for the neonate, and in future what all can happen. So what will happen during the labor process, all these things you will be explaining in detail to the mother. So in case already if she is having a baby, in case if she wants to continue with the pregnancy, she can continue. If she doesn't want to have a pregnancy, she need not have. So to make her understand, you are giving a prenatal counseling. So then comes the antenatal part. So antenatal part, so already you have diagnosed the mother is having gestational diabetes. So how are we going to take care of mother with diabetes? Okay, so first area is the antenatal care. So when we are coming to the antenatal care, the midwife takes a major role in providing care to the mothers. Okay, so in the early pregnancy, that is like around 20 weeks, that is in the first 20 weeks, the antenatal visits are like every month. Okay, so you are scheduling antenatal visits once in a month. Then after 20 weeks, like where you want to have a frequent visit with the mother, so you will be scheduling the antenatal visits every second week. Okay, so you have to go once in 2 weeks to visit the mother, or the mother has to visit the obstetrician once in 2 weeks. Okay, so that is with your antenatal care, where you will be analyzing the blood glucose level, the well-being of the mother, the well-being of the fetus, then the diet pattern, the exercises, whatever she is supposed to follow, all these things like you will be reinforcing every visits. Okay, so that is with the antenatal care. So then when we come to the areas or the self-care or the home care management, so in which all aspects you have to teach the mother. The first aspect, like where you are more worried, is the symptoms of hypoglycemia and your ketoacidosis. So what happens, why the mother is going in for hypoglycemia? So the first area, so when the mother is having hypoglycemia, okay, so what are we going to do? You start with an insulin therapy, exercise, diet and all those things you do. Suddenly what happens, sometimes there may be a decrease in the sugar level of the mother. So at that time the mother may go in for hypoglycemia. So you have to teach the mother what are the symptoms of hypoglycemia. What are the symptoms of hypoglycemia? The mother will have sudden sweating, slurred speech and like disoriented. So the mother reports like she is about to fall, like fainting, and all those symptoms she will be reporting, which indicates the mother is having hypoglycemia. So always, so whenever the mother is having hypoglycemia, she must have a sugar candy or a juice. And you have to teach the symptoms of ketoacidosis. So you know when the ketone bodies are getting excreted, you will get the ketone breath in the mouth. Okay, so those symptoms you have to teach the mother, like how ketoacidosis will happen. So with that, she will have an idea whether she is going in for complications. So where you can end that complication immediately as soon as she is able to rule up. And then coming to traveling. So when the mother is traveling, so we know always the mother, when she is going in for an antenatal visit or otherwise she is going somewhere outside shopping or something, she is going out, she has to be careful. She must have a bracelet labeled as diabetic, and she must carry her candies or chocolates or whatever, she is supposed to keep it in her bag every time. And she must be accompanied with somebody when like you suspect the mother can go in for a hypoglycemia. So in those type of conditions, like, she must be accompanied with somebody. And then coming to hospitalization. So hospitalization, when you have to do, see, in case if there is no events, if there is no problem, her index glycemic control is normal, she is holding as a normal food pattern, exercise, everything is under control, so no problem at all. Okay, so when it is like that, the baby's weight you will be assessing. When the weight of the baby is also normal, then you can plan very well. You can take the pregnancy till 37 weeks and then you can plan for the labor process. So, or otherwise, in case if the mother is having hypoglycemia, ketoacidosis, some other complications, hypoglycemia, so anything, whatever it is, that when the mother is facing some complications, she has to be hospitalized immediately. Okay, and then we have the LSCS. So you have to give an idea to the mother when this LSCS will be done. So when LSCS, you have to suspect an LSCS when there is a big baby, when the mother is not favoring, when the mother's condition is not favoring for a normal delivery, when the baby is big, when the mother is having complication, when this diabetic mellitus has caused some other complication, you are not able to conduct normal delivery, at that time you will be taking the mother for an LSCS section. So at that time you have to clearly give an idea to the mother, why are you taking it for a cesarean section. And then coming to the diet, so we have said like the dietary pattern, diabetic mother, she has to have a control over the diet. Okay, she must have a well balanced diet, like where she must add all her calories, proteins, fat. Like fat need not have an exceeding amount, like it has to be under control, or otherwise she can even cut down fat, like in case if she is too obese. Okay, she must provide a food which must have all micronutrients and macronutrients, so there it must be a well balanced diet, but the calories she has to cut down. Okay, then coming to the smoking pattern. So when we come to the smoking, you have to tell the mother there is complication of diabetes naturally, but again in case if she is smoking, definitely there will be vasculopathies, that is like when there is a decreased vasoperfusion. So at that time what happens, there is inadequate placental perfusion also, the child may go in for abortion if it is early. In case if it is in the later pregnancy, it can go in for premature delivery or preterm labor, maybe intrauterine growth retardation, intrauterine death, anything can happen. So all these things can be explained to the mother clearly. So when we come to the glucose level monitoring, so there must be a frequent glucose level monitoring according to the advice of the obstetrician or the midwife. Okay, so they will be telling like when they have to go in for glucose monitoring. So at that time they must have the blood glucose level to be assessed. It must be under control. And then coming to the exercises, you have to teach mother normal, that is like not straining too much, strainless exercises they have to teach. They must encouraged to go in for walking. They must be encouraged to go in for household works, like minimal, like keeping themselves active. All these things definitely decrease the sugar level of the mother. And then coming to the fetal monitoring, you have to assess the fetal growth. Okay, so whenever your obstetrician is telling you to take an ultrasonography, definitely you have to take this is to assess the weight of the baby. When there is an increased sugar level, there may be deposits in the baby which may cause big baby. So to assess for that, you need an ultrasonography to be done every now and then, so that you have to be doing that. Okay, and then we have insulin therapy. See, insulin therapy, usually you don't start for all the diabetes mother. Okay, so you have to tell the mother there must be a strict control over the diet and the exercises. In case if the level is not to be maintained, if she is unable to maintain the normal blood glucose level even with the diet and exercises, she has to go in for insulin therapy. So when you start with an insulin therapy, it is always insulin. Okay, so it is not oral hypoglycemic drug. So why no oral hyperglycemic drugs? In the sense, like, they can cross the placental barriers and they can cause congenital anomaly for the baby. So usually you don't encourage like oral glycemic drugs. Okay, so they have to be started with insulin therapy. So it is according to the requirement of the mother. So it is like 2 times or 3 times they will be starting with the drug, and they have to have a strict adherence to the diet pattern. So like once insulin is given, they must take food or something like within 30 minutes, so that the sugar level will be balanced, or otherwise she may go in for hypoglycemia. So all these complications have to be explained to the mother when you start with an insulin therapy. Okay, so this is what with your antenatal care. So when we are coming to the antenatal care, we have discussed about the symptoms of hypoglycemia, ketoacidosis, the traveling period, hospitalization, LSCS, diet, smoking, glucose levels, exercises, fetal monitoring, and the insulin therapy. Then let us discuss what we are going to do in the intranatal period. Okay, so intranatal period, see, I always say, see, intranatal period, it's very, very important period. Okay, so here you have to decide whether the mother can go in for normal delivery or otherwise she has to be taken for LSCS. So already I said, like, when you will be taking them for an LSCS session. Okay, so when the woman is having complications at that time, or otherwise it is normally you can go in for normal induction of labor. So usually induction will be done with your low rupture of membrane followed by oxytocin drips, and then like you will be adding fasten up in the labor process, okay, to decrease the second stage of labor. So those steps you have to be doing. Okay, so but this decision of normal labor and the LSCS session, that you have to decide according to the health condition of the mother. And then coming to the glucose monitoring, so usually you have to, once the labor process begins, you have to start with insulin therapy. So what is the normal dose? You have to start with 10 units of insulin in 500 ml of 5% dextrose. You have to start at a flow rate of 100 to 125 ml according to the weight of the mother. You have to start, so per hour you have to give 100 to 125 ml of insulin to the mother, and every hourly you will be monitoring the blood glucose level. So this flow rate you have to continue till the labor process. Like once the labor is over, sometimes there may be a decrease in the sugar level. When it is coming to 120 and like all those, like when it is coming to your normal range, you have to cut down, then she can proceed with a normal labor. So this is with your intranatal care. And when we are coming to the fetal monitoring, definitely you must have a continuous fetal monitoring. So usually you do a CTG. Continuous CTG will be done for the fetus. Okay, so cardiotocography is a very trustful tool to assess the functioning of the baby. Okay, so cardiotocography, you will be doing it continuously during the labor process. And then you can go in for fetal scalp blood pH analysis also you can do. and then you can also assess the respiratory distress syndrome for these type of baby in case if you suspect for complications. Okay, so these are the thing you will be assessing with the fetal monitoring. Then finally we come to the examination of the placenta and cord. So when we come to the examination of placenta and cord, it is always helpful for us to rule out whether the mother has undergone any complication during the labor process. Okay, so usually you have to assess for a single umbilical artery. So most of the time when the mother is having diabetes, there may be a complication that the woman is possessing with some congenital anomaly, and it is usually single umbilical artery you have to suspect. Like otherwise you can even rule out for placentosis. Okay, so placentosis is a condition where you will be assessing a group of areas with the placenta. So when you are suspecting placentosis, you have to rule out that the placenta will be large. So when the placenta is larger than the normal, so if it is a singleton pregnancy, you can think the placenta is going to be 500 grams. Okay, so in case if it is more than that, if it is bigger than that, you can suspect it is placentosis, and then you have to do a microscopic investigation which can rule out the villus is going to be edematous. There is an excessive knots and thickened membranes are seen during a placental examination microscopically. So these are all like indicating there is an abnormal placenta and cord. We'll see the care during the puerperal period. Okay, so puerperal period, like you have to be again very careful with the insulin therapy. So already the patient is under continuous flow. Okay, so insulin is flowing continuously during the labor process to have the sugar under control. So now once the labor is over, the demand for insulin may come down. Okay, so you have to be careful. So you have to assess, like every hourly you have to monitor the glucose level of the mother. So then according to that you can cut down the dosages, and then you have to give 500 plus kilocalories accordingly. That is like for the lactating mother, you have to give 500 calories plus. And then we have lactation. So in case if the mother is lactating nicely and if the baby is feeding adequately, then the demand for insulin comes down. So naturally the demand for insulin comes down. Okay, so then this is with your puerperal period. Then finally when we are coming to the baby part, fetal well-being, you have to assess. Like once the baby is born, you have to be very careful with the insulin level of the baby also. Again, the baby is also prone for hypoglycemia. So you have to assess the sugar level of the baby every second hourly, and in case if the baby is going in for hypoglycemia, you have to start with dextrose, and then you have to assess for hypoxia of the baby. Then you will also be giving vitamin K supplements immediately, and then start with breastfeeding. The best thing is like you have to put the baby in the breast of the mother like within half an hour to 1 hour, like where the baby can be prevented for hypoglycemia. Okay, so this is with the management of diabetes mellitus. I know this is a vast topic, so already we have divided the topic into two areas. Okay, so in management part we have discussed the management part in very detailed area of antenatal, intranatal and the postnatal and the care of the baby. So in case even more than this, if you have any doubts, kindly go and get your doubts clarified in the comment box. Okay, take care, bye, let's see in the next class.